You're listening to a podcast from EvidenceNetwork.ca, making evidence matter in Canadian health policy, in partnership with the Canadian Frailty Network, improving care for older Canadians living with frailty by connecting science, healthcare, patients, families, and caregivers. What does getting old look like in Canada? John Muscedere, Scientific Director and CEO of the Canadian Frailty Network, says it would look a lot better if we would just listen to our elders.
Well, that's right. There's nothing like listening to the people who have the lived experience, and the reality is that we're all of us are getting older, so we'll all have that lived experience, and we'll be able to push the redevelopment of care based on our expectations and what we want out of it.
For over 1 million Canadians today, getting older includes medical frailty. That's 25% of people over age 65 and 50% of people over age 85. Within a decade, the number of frail elderly Canadians will double. They're a population that's growing, but not well understood, which means our healthcare research, planning, and care for them could be misguided. The most common mistake? Muscedere says it's assuming that frailty and aging are the same thing.
Frailty and aging are not synonymous. People who, as the age advances, your risk of being frail increases, but they are not the same. And frailty is a state of increased vulnerability where minor changes or minor healthcare challenges can result in dramatic dramatic deteriorations in health status.
Someone who is frail may already be juggling multiple health problems, or maybe they're not eating and exercising as well as they used to. Maybe it's tougher to get to doctor's appointments, or maybe they're spending too much time alone. These factors contribute to medical vulnerability, or frailty. When people are frail, minor incidents like injuries from falling, catching colds, aren't just health setbacks. They can escalate into life-threatening conditions. As scary as that sounds, Kathy McGilton, a senior scientist at the Toronto Rehabilitation Institute, says understanding frailty from a patient's perspective is key to delaying, preventing, even turning it around.
So I think what happens is we make huge assumptions when people actually get sick that they automatically are kind of going to be frail for the rest of their lives. Heck no, if we do better assessments, we actually see people have actually quite a few abilities. We have to do better assessments and we have to get them back to where they should be. Now, some clients, of course, post-stroke, you're never going to regain your pre-morbid function, but for a lot of clients, you actually can do much better. So it's that slippery slope notion of you just assume because you're old, you can't do it. I think we have to change that. We have to realize you've had a setback. What do we need to do to help you get back to where you need to be as independent as possible?
So what do our elderly want us to know? Unlike most medical research that measures success based on days in hospital or life expectancy, people living with frailty are focused on quality of life. They're not as preoccupied with living longer so much as living better. They want to live at home and, when asked, have some pretty good ideas about what they need to do it. Their top priority is better coordinated health care and social supports. Muscedere explains what this might look like.
At the minimum, it means that that information is the same no matter which provider that you see, and all the therapies that are being delivered by different providers, even if they're in different places, are all consistent with one another. But the ideal would be, that's right, that you go to one place, one setting, and you receive all the care there, all the support services are there, such that you do not need to go to multiple appointments, multiple places.
Older Canadians are also concerned for the well-being of their families and caregivers. Muscedere explains.
Our healthcare system would grind to a halt without the availability of informal caregivers or caregivers either within the family or within friends or within the community. And I think as we go forward, that probably needs to be recognized much more And as a system and as a society, we probably need to be able to facilitate that or recognize it more or reward it more, such that it is not it's not perceived to be as big of a burden or a disruption to people's lives when they provide care.
Many elderly Canadians live far away from family members, so their second priority is healthcare services and treatments that acknowledge possible isolation, no healthcare advocate, or live-in family and caregiver. This might mean transportation services or extra social supports. And on a related note, the third priority includes having more community and home-based services, supports that manage or slow the progression of frailty. As McGilton explains, just as aging doesn't have to mean frailty, frailty doesn't have to mean hopeless.
There is still so much potential to do better than you ever would imagine if given the right resources, if you have the right mindset. Most people can do quite a bit better. Yes, you might live with an impairment, but if we can provide support, you're not isolated at home, you could actually do quite a bit better than I think we're doing with some of our Canadians.
Which is refreshingly optimistic.
Oh, I'm happy to hear that. That's my job, just to try to change, you know, people's thinking and perceptions, and hopefully care eventually will follow.
For Evidence Network, I'm Nita Das McMurtry. You're listening to a podcast from EvidenceNetwork.ca, making evidence matter in Canadian health policy. Connect with the latest nonpartisan health research from experts across Canada and around the world, or sign up to receive our free monthly e-newsletter at www.evidencenetwork.ca. You can also subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. EvidenceNetwork.ca is funded by the Canadian Foundation for Healthcare Improvement, the Canadian Institutes of Health Research, Research Manitoba, and the University of Winnipeg.